Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak to Dr. Elizabeth Matsui, a professor of population health and pediatrics at the University of Texas Dell Medical School. Dr. Matsui is a pediatric allergist and immunologist who studies environmental exposures and their impact on respiratory diseases. We speak about how the novel coronavirus is transmitted through the air and what can be done to stop it. Let's listen. Dr. Matsui, thank you so much for joining me. I want to start with a simple question. What is airborne spread of a virus?
So thank you for having me. And I appreciate that question. I will say that it's not such a simple question, but I'll try to break it down for everyone. So essentially, that term is used interchangeably with aerosol spread or with another term that's called droplet nuclei spread. And what people mean by that is that there are viruses that are infectious that are in small particles that people exhale or cough or sneeze or produce when they sing or talk that remain suspended in the air for a long time and that can travel longer distances in the air than the larger droplets that people produce when they sneeze or cough. And those larger droplets typically will fall to the ground in a shorter distance. And those are called droplet spread. The airborne transmission is defined as I just described, which is these smaller particles that travel further.
So the novel coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2, there's controversy over whether there's airborne transmission. Could you explain to me what that controversy is?
Absolutely. So the environmental health sciences community, which includes people who are experts in airborne particles and their aerosol scientists, very much have been advocating for evidence that exists that supports airborne transmission. And some communities, the scientific communities, have been reluctant to embrace that evidence, and they have reasons that are appropriate to be concerned about the evidence. But I think we're in a situation where that evidence is strong enough that we need to stop and think about what it means because it has implications for what we might do to intervene. And
so could you give me an example of what that evidence is? Like right. If someone were making the case, I think there's airborne transmission, what would they be pointing to?
So there are really three lines of evidence. One is what we know about particles that are emitted when we breathe or talk or speak and how far they travel. The second line of evidence is that we know that at least the genetic material or the nucleic acid of the virus has been detected in places, for example, in hospitals outside of rooms where patients are staying. So it suggests that it travels there somehow. And then the third line of evidence are these case reports or observations where we have super spreading events that are occurring in the context of physical distancing. And so people wonder how might that have occurred? And the best explanation for those case reports is really airborne transmission.
In other words, people who think they're doing everything right, but nonetheless still get sick.
Correct.
So why aren't people just embracing the idea that there's airborne transmission? What's the argument on the other side?
So the counter argument goes something like this. So the household attack rate for SARS-CoV-2 is lower than for some classic airborne pathogens like measles or tuberculosis, that it's incredibly hard to measure virus in air that someone's exhaling or an exhaled breath. And so there's a bit of an argument that because we haven't connected the dots between particles that people exhale, measuring the virus in them, in those particles, and then demonstrating that, a susceptible person then is breathing those particles in And that's how they get infected, because we're missing some of the evidence that connects all those dots. Then the argument is there's really not strong enough or incontrovertible evidence to point to this. A third argument is, I think, a non-scientific argument, and you would have an interesting perspective to share, I'm sure, about this, which is there's concern that if you start using the term airborne transmission, that that kind of communication will cause people to panic more than they should panic.
Well, let's talk about what the implications are from a scientific perspective for these different modes of transmission. So if something is not thought generally to transmit through airborne transmission, how do you protect yourself from that?
So physical distancing, because if someone is coughing or sneezing and producing droplets that are the main source of the infection, those droplets fall to the ground pretty readily. We can have a debate about whether 6 feet is appropriate or not, but the concept is the further away you are from someone who sneezes or coughs, the less likely you're going to be exposed to those droplets. And what we haven't talked about, and we can leave to the side now, is fomites, which are infectious material that's on surfaces that you might touch. And that may happen because a droplet lands on a doorknob or something and you touch the doorknob. So hand washing is very helpful also, you know, in those circumstances. And so those types of interventions for droplet spread are typically very effective.
But they don't necessarily work for airborne. So what do you add to that, or what else do you do differently if you're concerned about airborne transmission?
So wear a mask. And there's a whole nother discussion that can be had about masks specifically, but cloth masks are very helpful. So they help reduce the particles that you might be exhaling into the environment if you're infected and don't know it. And we now know that transmission by people who are not yet symptomatic or don't have symptoms is pretty important. So wearing a mask all the time helps reduce the viruses that you may be emitting into the air around you. It also does protect you somewhat from inhaling those sort of smaller particles. So that's something you can do on kind of an individual behavioral change level. But the other things that are important have to do with how many people are in an enclosed space or an indoor space. And so it looks like airborne transmission that's occurring with SARS-CoV-2 may not be the same as measles or tuberculosis, which may be sort of particles that can be transmitted over long, long distances, but instead maybe over shorter distances. So being indoors is a potential risk, and the more people who are indoors and the less ventilation there is in that place, the more likely that someone who is infected and exhaling or talking and emitting particles in the air is going to emit enough particles in the air that hang around long enough that a susceptible person will inhale them and become infected. And so there are things we can do at the building level to try to reduce those factors that promote conditions that facilitate airborne transmission.
So it sounds like it's not exactly that we have been picking one approach or another approach. It's always been a little bit of a mix. And the question now is whether we should be adding additional precautions as evidence is appearing suggesting airborne transmission. Would you say that's generally fair?
I think that that's fair. And I might, in a crude way, categorize those as individual behaviors that you can think about. But I think you and I both think about what can be done sort of across a community or a population. So individual behaviors are, if you have to go to the grocery store or pick up a prescription, finding a time when there are very few people in the store is one way. Or if you need to eat something, takeout is obviously better, but you certainly should not go indoors in a restaurant because there's less ventilation in indoor spaces than just being outdoors where the virus fits airborne would be diluted. Mm-hmm. But then there are things that can be potentially done across the community. So some, you know, Harvard actually put out a report about how to think about building ventilation and air filtration for schools to try to reduce the potential concentration of airborne viruses in school settings and reduce the risk of transmission. And that's where I think we have not really started to think deeply about the implications of airborne transmission. And there's an opportunity there to think about how we can intervene at the building level and the community level in these ways that might buy us more time and reduce transmission while we work towards a vaccine and treatment and prevention.
Now, there are definitely some people who say that that might be a little bit of a wild goose chase to be doing all these different environmental interventions when most people who get sick have a very strong exposure history, that they could be a household contact, for example, of someone who's already sick, and that you don't necessarily see so many examples of everyone in an office setting getting sick. And it's pretty rare, like maybe at a choir where people are singing, but not necessarily where people are sitting quietly doing work. How far do you think we should go in terms of investing resources to A, understand this better, or B, you know, try to fix up, you know, a whole bunch of different ventilation systems?
Right. I think there are ways to think carefully about how to implement it kind of in a pilot way and test the effect to understand whether those sorts of interventions are worth investing in. And so I'm not advocating for, you know, widespread $100,000 overhauls of every building in the country with new air systems, et cetera, et cetera. I'm advocating for people who are in the position of thinking about indoor spaces. And those may include universities and schools and government buildings and so on and so forth, religious buildings, that it is worth pausing and thinking about the ventilation in those spaces. And that can be measured in terms of air changes per hour, to think about filtration and whether there is an appropriately highly effective filter that's in place, to think about opportunities to reduce density in those indoor spaces. And then to think about opportunities for either the existing HVAC system to entrain outdoor air, or maybe to, you know, open windows depending on the climate. And I think there's some simple things that can be done that are not very expensive. And even for the more expensive things, there may be ways to, as they're being implemented, assess their effectiveness so that we can quickly start to learn about to what extent the full kind of spectrum of these building level interventions might be appropriate, for example, across a school system. I did want to add one caveat, which is that there is another case report of spread of the virus in a call center in Korea. I don't know if you saw that report.
No.
So obviously these are people who are talking because it's a call center, but there was a high attack rate in this call center where, and it was an open office type of plan. So office spread like that can happen.
So it sounds like on the one hand, there's an important research agenda. And on the other hand, there may be things that make sense to do, particularly if they're not that expensive. Something that comes to mind might be people in an office environment, even if they're indoors and 6 feet away, maybe it's a good idea for them to wear masks.
Absolutely. And I'm glad you brought that up, because most of the conversations I've had with people in terms of workplaces opening up include, you know, universal masking policy. And here in Austin, you know, we are really having a major surge in COVID, and we had a universal masking regulation come down from, you know, the mayor's office. And so people are required to wear them in indoor spaces, at least. And I think that that is a cultural shift for us to embrace that, but it's inexpensive and not hard to do.
One question about the research agenda. Is there a good enough model to know whether air is infectious? In other words, could you walk in somewhere, get a sample and say, yep, this could cause someone to have COVID, and then you could do something to the filtration system and then see whether that helps? Or are we in a position that we're just not quite sure yet how to measure the outcome, you know, short of people getting sick?
Yeah. So the simple thing to do is that you can measure ventilation in the space with a carbon dioxide monitor. And that's something that any kind of commercial outfit that assesses buildings can do that very quickly. That, of course, doesn't tell you if there's infectious material in the air, because in order for there to be infectious material in the air, there needs to be someone, or potentially in the air, there needs to be someone in that building space who's infected. And one of the counterarguments for the airborne transmission concept is that it's actually really hard to measure viable, you know, virus in the air. And you can, but you have to collect a large volume of air. And then by the time that you take that sample and then get it tested in a lab, a couple days has passed. And that sample is only meaningful if there was someone who was in that space or that environment who was infectious. So you could get a false negative, right? Because you happened to sample the grocery store at a time when there was nobody who was infectious. And then by the time that you learn about a positive test, it's too late to do anything about it unless you want to use it as a marker for needing to change, you know, aspects of how the building's ventilated or the air is filtered.
I see. So at some point, we may see more data, for example, that more ventilation is associated with fewer cases, and that would give some impetus to more of these interventions.
I think so. And there is a literature, you know, that people who are aerosol scientists are much more familiar with than I am, where these sorts of interventions have been effective for other pathogens. So it's not a sort of controversial idea at all.
Got it. So really, when we're seeing these debates about airborne transmission or not airborne transmission, they're partly questions of what can we do to protect ourselves better, and prioritizing research into understanding which interventions will matter the most.
Yeah, and I think that that's generally true. I might point out that there's a semantic issue too, which is there's a lot of controversy about just the term airborne transmission. So sometimes the controversy is about that. I would also say that this isn't really just a research agenda, because there are things that can be deployed now that have some evidence. They're not direct evidence for this particular virus, and that when it's being deployed, we shouldn't kind of miss out on the opportunity to measure its effectiveness when it's deployed.
And on that list would be the filtration.
Ventilation and filtration. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you so much for explaining this to me. It was very helpful. I really appreciate your time.
Well, thanks for having me. I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.